Okay, we don't have time for this. Just get to the intro. This is Brand New Relic, the monthly series where I finally play the classic games I never got to try. First off, spoilers ahead for Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic, so if you don't want to know what happens, then definitely stay off Wikipedia. Yes, about as long as we've had Star Wars video games. Starting with The Empire Strikes Back on the Atari 2600, which looks like that, all the way to the stunning and motion sickness-inducing release of Star Wars Squadrons just 3 months ago. Who would have thought that one beardy, flannelly man would create a massive entertainment empire with his little story about a farmhand named Luke... Starkiller? And see, this is why writers go through a second draft. So what better time to play a Star Wars game than January, because... Okay, Jeremy, why do Star Wars in January? All the movies came out in May or December. Well, it's because January is when I saw The Force Awakens in the theater for the third time. Nice save. There are over 100 officially licensed Star Wars games, and many more that are very much unlicensed. But which one is the best? Well, according to Variety, Games Radar, Sci-Fi, various YouTubers, and my Patreon voters, it's this one. I've been hearing about Knights of the Republic for 18 years now. This game can vote. It can smoke. It can be hit on by its much older college professors. It's not only widely considered the greatest Star Wars game ever made, but one of the greatest games of all time, period. And I've been a Star Wars fan my entire life. I can't remember the first time I watched the trilogy. So why didn't I play this game back in the day? Oh, right, because I didn't own an Xbox and my computer at the time freaked out if I tried to open up an attachment from my Earthlink account. So after doing a bunch of work to get the game to play at 1080p, I'm ready to bring a little 2003 into 2021. I know that Knights of the Old Republic, or KOTOR, was developed by BioWare, who made Baldur's Gate, Dragon Age, and Mass Effect, none of which I've played. Wow, I really haven't played much, have I? I know that's the point of this series, but sometimes I surprise myself with how few games I've actually gone through. And I know that the game is called Knights of the Old Republic, so it's about the Republic, which is old and has knights. So yeah, okay, I really don't know much about this one. Let's change all that now. I start by creating my character, and yeah, I'm just a scoundrel. I need a Star Wars name, so these rules that I found on the internet means that I'm Jerga Mylak. There's something about the Star Wars opening that always gets me excited. I wake up in a space station that's under attack, and hey, don't just barge in when I'm not wearing pants. Especially when you're just gonna give me sass.
And I'll admit, the Republic is in desperate need of someone with your kind of skills. Desperate enough to overlook your shady past.
I put on some rather sexy pants and meet up with Karth, whose voice is not very consistent from line to line.
You can't use your stealth skill without one.
Use the mouse and click on the stealth button to activate it.
But that's fine, because he's a bit of a dreamboat. We escape the station before it's destroyed and make our way to the planet Terrace. Wow, I'm a very restless sleeper, huh? I dream about this badass before waking up and getting an exposition dump from Karth. And then we have to figure out how to get off this planet. So I leave our apartment and yeah, okay, I'm gonna have to listen to a lot of alien languages, aren't I? Uh-huh. Oh, sure. He didn't. In the apartment building, we kill a bunch of Sith, only to find out that they don't bother the people in this apartment. Didn't we kill a bunch of them for bothering people in this apartment? And I love switching from one party member to the other.
Uh-huh.
What?
Uh-huh.
What?
Uh-huh.
What?
Uh-huh.
What?
And then, is it just me, or is there something going on between me and Karth?
I'm all ears, beautiful.
But it's hard to have a conversation with this guy walking around. And we find out that the government here is slow on administering a vaccine to the population during a pandemic. That's aged well. And down in front! Couldn't have said it better myself. In order to save the galaxy, we have to find a Jedi named Bastila, which proves difficult with guys like these.
A drink? Hey! For a slummy, you ain't so bad!
Good to know this type of dude exists in every galaxy. And then we dress up as the Sith because know thy enemy, I guess. We break into their apartment and basically just kill everyone living there. You know, like a hero. And then I go to this cantina where we meet Kalo Nord, a counting bounty hunter. Would that make him a county hunter? Then I help a Twi'lek with her dancing audition. Video games, everybody. We meet the leader of a local gang who's blind, and no, don't ask him about his eyes. Then we run into a Mandalorian. Hey, I've seen that show. His name is Candris, and bye, I guess. We meet someone named Mission and her Wookiee companion.
You got a problem with me? Then you got a problem with Big Z.
She's giving me some real Harley Quinn vibes. But the Wookiee gets kidnapped, so she joins our party.
I'm here.
Yeah?
Ready?
What?
Huh?
What?
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 I'm here.
What?
And I die for the first time, which is how I learned to quick save. So then we save the Wookiee and get a life vow. So we're married now? Is that what happened? I mean, he's an attractive Wookiee. Although Mission won't stop talking about his bad breath, so maybe not. Besides, we still have Karth here. Except we can only have two other people in my party, so back to the apartment, Karth. And then we meet this cutie patootie. I try fighting it, sneaking past it, running past it, before realizing that I should be reading the data pads I'm picking up, which tells me to poison it. That's how we do it in the Outer Rim territories! So it turns out I can only get to Bastila in true RPG fashion. Let's see, she was kidnapped, so to free her, I have to win her in a swoop bike race, but in order to win a swoop bike race, I need a swoop bike. And there's a gang that can get me a swoop bike, but in order to be fast enough, I need certain parts, and those parts can only be found at the base of a rival gang. You know how it goes. So I end up killing a lot of people in order to get some swoop bike parts.
Take that!
Yes, please, take that. Turns out the reason I get to ride the swoop bike is that it possibly has an exploding accelerator, so that's fun. But it turns out the race was easy.
Whoa!
And then Bastila just frees herself. Why couldn't she do this before? She escapes with us and, oh, okay, she's the Jedi in my dream.
That's how I know her!
Turns out that Bastila is less than pleasant.
You mean you don't have a plan to get off Taurus yet? What have you been doing all this time?
But she reveals that I have Force sensitivity, so suck it, everyone else! So then I have an all-femme team, hell yeah! And we learn a card game, because what's an RPG without a card game? It's called Bazaak, and forget the quest, I just want to play Bazaak. And, want to put some clothes on, Bastila? Protocol droids keep interrupting important conversations, and wait, skank is a word in the galaxy? I help to deliver the vaccine to the people, and then I take it back. Look at Mitch McConnell over here. We need to buy a droid to get us into the Sith base, and I can't afford 2,000 credits, so I threaten the shop owner and get my first dark side points.
Good!
We defeat a Sith Lord who seems like a real fun guy.
My master will surely reward me with my lightsaber once I kill you.
Team up with the Mandalorian Candoris, and then just like that, we're out of Upper City. To get back at us, the Sith decide to blow up the entire planet of Terrace, which is a bit extreme. And in order to leave the system, we need to hijack the Ebon Hawk, which is the fastest ship around? But is it faster than the Millennium Falcon? Oh, you know what? The internet's already asked this question, haven't they? Yep, there it is. While hatching our plan, we... bye. I can only have a male slave? Get with the times. Yes, I know, but still. I will say, though, that a massage sounds nice right about now. We release a lot of gas... before facing off against the terrifying County Hunter, who's... Well, there you go. Guess he wasn't counting on that. Oh, I'm so sorry. And then an entire planet is destroyed, but these six people survived. Hooray? There's a gunning section, which is very awkward to do with a mouse. And we get some prequel-era cutscenes on our way to Dantooine, where we land at the Jedi Academy. Who am I? Why, I'm Jedi. And hey, it's Grogu. I speak to the Jedi Council, and I keep being given the option to lie. This wasn't happening before. Why does this game want me to lie to the Jedi so much? Turns out I'm getting trained as a Jedi, which means it's time for a good old-fashioned montage. Weeks have passed, apparently, and I'm ready to complete a trivia challenge.
There is no shame in admitting weakness.
And is it just me, or does the Jedi Council sound like the group that runs the Good Place?
The Republic petitioned the Jedi Council for aid, but there were many factors to consider before we allowed ourselves to be drawn into another conflict.
Hear, hear.
Ooh, Callan, did you file a hear, hear memorandum?
No. Sincerest apologies. I rescind my hear, hear and resign, effective immediately.
And Bastila, down in front! I decide to be a Jedi Consular, and it's time to make my lightsaber, which would normally cost $200 at Disneyland, so that's a deal. The exact nature of the taint has not been made clear. You know, that's true with the exact nature of most taints. And hey, it's Nemo! Found him! I kill a bunch of dogs, as well as some Mandalorians, so is the show cancelled now? Okay, can everyone stop saying taint? Jedi trainee Juhani joins our group, and we meet someone named Adum LARP? What does this game have against LARPs? And I just realized that my lightsaber makes the Price is Right horn sound. And then I become a Padawan!
Yippee!
And we find some crystals!
I'm struck and rich!
And then we're helping Space Romeo and Space Juliet.
Father!
Mr. Matale!
Grahesha!
Father!
Mr. Sandril!
Murik!
Alan!
Enid!
Dr. Scott!
Janet!
Ah! Rucker!
We will praise you to the Council for what you have done, and name our children after you.
So your children will be named Jurga and Mylak? That'll go well for them. The Jedi Council informs me that the Sith are setting up shop in the Star Forge, which is a kind of Death Star? And in order to find it, we have to collect a series of maps. If we destroy the Star Forge, then I guess I get to become a Knight of the Old Republic? Is that how that works? So we're off to Tatooine, the most famous desert wasteland outside of Las Vegas. Meanwhile, the Sith Lord Malak is after us, and has no one told him that he kinda looks like a goober? Oh, he's still alive? He's going to count at us so hard. And should I invest in some sleeping pills or something? It turns out that there's a stowaway in our ship, and I have to learn a language like I'm in Heaven's Vault. Along with the stowaway, we get these new pets, and I already love them. Although I always have the option of killing them, which is disturbing. Then we have to buy a translator droid, and where's C-3PO when you need him? Wait, when does this game take place in the Star Wars universe? So C-3PO is about 4,000 years away from being built. Never mind then. Okay, but this droid is amazing.
Ready!
We need to broker peace with the Sand People, which we do by killing a bunch of them and stealing their clothes. Then we meet Comad, so that we can kill a crate dragon who guards the first star map. Oh, I hope this tells me where Mark Ruffalo lives. We face off against the bounty hunter for the last time, and he counts his last count. I spend way too long trying to defeat this guy at Pazok, fail miserably winning a swoop race.
Now this is pod racing!
And then we're off to Kashyyyk. Or Kashyyyk! Where we get more growling than the Star Wars Holiday Special. We find out that Malak fought his master Revan and left them for dead, so Revan's 100% still alive then. I have to help out the Wookiees in order to gain access to the second star map, so I go down to Kashyyyk's surface where this noise doesn't get annoying at all. I invest in ridiculous-looking eyewear, and then I meet Jolie, a Jedi hermit who joins our party. We engage in another trivia challenge that is frankly a bit twisted, and then like King Arthur, we pull the sword from the side of a gross monster. We get access to the star map, which doesn't tell me where Tessa Thompson lives. And wait, I got light side and dark side points? I'm so in conflict with myself. Then we help start a civil war against the Wookiees, sorry, everyone. And I feel like there could have been better camera placement in this scene. But the Wookiees rise up against their oppressors, good job y'all, and it's on to the next planet. But not before checking in with Malak and his new apprentice, who clearly has some anger issues. So we land on this planet where something's a bit fishy. Yeah, I said it, fight me! We have a long conversation where this guy just keeps trying to interrupt, and even Juhani gets in on that action. And oh, wait, hold on, I just realized I should upgrade our lightsabers. So it's back to Dantooine, which has the only workbench I can remember off the top of my head. We head back to Manon, but not before having a sudden space battle, and I just realized I can use the keyboard. That makes this so much easier. It turns out the Republic and the Sith are living here in harmony. Sorta, not really. We talk to two Sith soldiers who sound exactly the same.
Enough time to listen to your stories. I've got a full shipment of Kalto ready to load before my shift is over. Enough time to listen to your stories. I've got a full shipment of Kalto ready to load before my shift is over. Enough time to listen to your stories.
And I don't take it well when I can't open a door.
On it. Damn!
I somehow get assigned to be someone's lawyer.
Objection!
And this place has a nightlife? The fish planet has a nightlife? I get to know Jolie more, and I really wish I hadn't asked any questions.
Well, let's just say that I was a strapping young lad with a full head of hair.
Oh, I tied an onion to my belt! Which was the style at the time?
And I can respond with, "I hate you, old man," which is absolutely the correct response. We sneak into the Sith embassy and just straight up commit murder. So naturally we're arrested, and we lie our way to innocence. Our heroes! And then we find out that the guy that we're defending actually committed the crime, but we convince the judges to find him innocent. Are we sure I'm on the light side here? Anyway, to get to the star map, we have to go underwater. We
all live in a Slate Gray Submersible.
Turns out the Cellcath are attacking everyone, including this vaudeville comedian hiding in a locker.
Investigate!
You're just like the others. Fodder for the Selkath. Walking fishnecks. Chomp, chomp, chomp. If you can run, you might be fast food.
We meet a survivor who sounds like he's in a radio play.
All my companions are dead. The Selkath swarmed over us. There were dozens of them.
And then...
Don't just stand there. We have to keep moving. The water is filled with...
Filled with what? Hey, what's the water filled with? But it turns out the sharks can be killed with an ear-piercing sound. But there's a bigger shark out there.
This shark, swallow you whole.
And in order to kill it, I have to solve the puzzle from Die Hard with a Vengeance. But I do it! Third star map down! Will this one lead me to the house of Chris Hemsworth? We take down Malik's apprentice, and it seems like we're on our way to the fourth location before we get picked up by a low-poly Aaron Paul.
Bitch!
Who strips us of our clothes and tells us that the Jedi Academy was destroyed? Wow, harsh. He tries to get information from me by torturing Karth, but I've gotten over him, so that means nothing. But we escape and confront Malik, who reveals that... Wait, what? It turns out that I'm Revan, Malik's old Sith Master. Malik defeated me, left me for dead, and the Jedi gave me a new identity. Which is, you know, not great of them. But it's better than hanging out with this guy. Although he does have a lovely sense of humor. Bastila sacrifices herself so that we can get away, and on the ship, we tell our crew the truth. And hold on, Mission, are you still wearing your Tusken Raider disguise? And Candras, put on a shirt, what's going on in this ship? I try to tell everyone that I'm no longer part of the Sith, which is difficult when I'm literally wearing Dark Jedi robes, that's on me. But they're all still on my side, so I go to Yavin to find... nothing. So then I go to Korriban, which is where the Sith Academy is. No one seems to recognize their former leader walking around as I try to gain favor with the Sith equivalent of Dumbledore.
Welcome, welcome to another year at
the dark side.
I bypass a bunch of Indiana Jones-style obstacles, get a sword from Casper the Friendly Sith, who talks like he's at the Monster Mash.
I had a name once. Ajunta Paul. Yes, that was my name.
And we find the fourth and final star map, which will help me find the house of Taika Waititi. And yes, I'm just trying to find the stars of Thor Ragnarok. It's my favorite Marvel movie. So we take off for the Starforge when, yeah, of course we get stopped. It's an RPG. I go to see the One.
I know Kung Fu.
Who wants me to kill a bunch of elders, very Logan's run of him. But the elders want me to help release a prisoner being held by the One. Fortunately, I'm a Jedi Consular, so I'm very good at being able to meditate between both sides and- Oh, okay, I guess not this time. Well, I'm on the side of the elders because they let me use their gong. They help me gain access to a nearby temple.
Legends of the Hidden Temple.
And it turns out that Malik is still after me. Chin up, buddy. And he's managed to turn Bastila to the dark side. No!
But in our shared visions of the star maps, I also felt the so-called taint within you.
Oh, I was so worried that I wouldn't hear the word taint again. So now we're finally at the Starforge, where we fight waves and waves and waves and waves and waves of enemies before turning Bastila back to good. I shut down a horde of murderous robots.
I'm a hacker!
And then I face Darth Malik by running away a lot. But I finally take him down, and he actually has a pretty poignant death.
What would have happened had our positions been reversed?
We escape the Starforge before it's destroyed, and then we're given a hero's welcome. With like 20 people. And a lot of my crew missing their clothes. Whatever, I'll take it. Then we get to the end credits, and wait, Ed Asner was in this?
Now, we're gonna walk to the falls quickly and quietly with no rap music or flash dancing.
And that's a wrap on Knights of the Old Republic, where... Wait, I just realized this was a BioWare game. Could I have romanced anyone? What? I could have been a polyamorous pansexual Jedi? Well, time to play this all over again, I guess. Pretty much everything. Knights of the Old Republic holds up incredibly well. There's a clear reason why this is considered the best Star Wars game of all time. Much like the movies, it's filled with little details that help make this a living, breathing world. From the junked spaceship that's just there for atmosphere, to seeing a ship flying through the air from very far away, it's clear that you're just one story in this world, and finding those little details throughout is a joy. Every look and sound in the game feels like it belongs right in the Star Wars universe, albeit in the prequel era when this game was made.
I don't like sand.
And despite having pretty much nothing connecting it to the Skywalker saga, this is unmistakably a Star Wars story. A tale of good and evil, of technology and spirituality. It's a captivating story with a major twist that is beautifully revealed. Much like the prequels, there's not a whole lot of humor. This game plays things pretty seriously, but everyone in your party has their own unique quirks, and the voiceover work is more dynamic than, say, oh, I don't know, Queen Amidala.
That is something I cannot do.
This is also the third RPG that I've played for this series, which means that it's another battle system to learn, and this one was my favorite. If you encounter an easy enemy, you can just charge forward and take care of them quickly enough, but when presented with a challenge, you can pause the game and strategize each character's next move. It manages to make the gameplay fast and fun while also allowing you to take a breath and make a plan of attack when needed. And the generous save system ensures that you don't lose a lot of progress and also gives you the chance to get creative with save file names. Being an RPG means that there are side quests, and for the most part they were very enjoyable. From deciding whether to save a creeper who is being threatened by his long-suffering wife, destroying a droid whose sacrifice will help a grieving widow move on, or helping your stowaway find her home, none of the quests felt arbitrary. And even the card game Pazak is really fun. I refused anyone who wanted to play Gwent when I went through Witcher 3, but every time someone asked if I wanted to play Pazak, I usually made time. I liked the game so much that I downloaded an app on my phone that's just Pazak. So yeah, there's very little in here that I didn't like. Oh, but I should talk about that, huh? Okay, well, I mean, not much. Let's see, I guess there wasn't a lot in the way of music. Most of it was just ambient noise, and what was there wasn't very memorable, and also cut in and out at odd times. And while I'm sure it looked fine in 2003, the looks of the human characters leave much to be desired now. Except for you, Karth. And it can be kind of annoying to start a quest in one area, go all the way to the second area for the next part of the quest, then have to travel all the way back to the first area to complete the quest. But that's really about it. Nothing here that super frustrated me, nothing story-wise that hasn't aged well, nothing that got in the way of my enjoyment of the game. I gotta say, it all works. So yeah, I guess we move on to... Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic is still definitely worth playing. It's by far my favorite RPG I've played in the series so far, maybe only second to Silent Hill 2 in my current ranking of this season's titles, and it's perhaps my favorite piece of prequel-era Star Wars entertainment, and no, I haven't seen Clone Wars yet, so maybe it's Clone Wars, but for right now, it's not Clone Wars. Anyway, I definitely look forward to playing through this one again, perhaps to see what happens when I turn to the dark side.
Good!
In the meantime, I'm gonna go back to playing Pazak. A big shout-out to my Patreon followers, but an even bigger shout-out to Brianne Shaw and Haley's mom. Along with everyone in the Palm Tree Panic tier and above, they got to see this video 3 days early. If you want access to a bunch of perks and benefits, then...
give us some money!
And if you want to enjoy my work for free, you can. You can follow me on Twitter, you can like and subscribe and hit the notification bell to find out about future episodes. You have options. My next episode takes a look at a game that, according to grown-ups at the time, was corrupting my young, impressionable mind. So until then, thank you so much for watching.